Nidhaye sarva vidyanam, vishaye bhavaroginam, gurave sarva lokanam, dakshinamurtaye namaha. Ishvaro guru ratmeti murti bheda vibhagine, vyomavad vyaptadehaya, dakshinamurtaye namaha. Welcome to this talk on Vastu Shastra for Good Health. And I welcome you. I am Mr.Shekhar, Khandalekar. I'll be expressing the knowledge which has been passed down by tradition to all you people. Vastu Shastra is not something very new to people right now. Though the word has got an Indian ring to it, it was quite alien to us around 15-20 years back. Now, nobody knew much about Vastu Shastra at that time. But right now, there are so many media through which Vastu Shastra has been made popular in today's society. There are various books, newspapers, and TV channels through which Vastu Shastra has been made quite popular. So many of you who are here would have already have some idea about what Vastu Shastra stands for. So I would like to get acquainted with what is your idea about Vastu Shastra. Anybody? Okay, so Vastu Shastra is for correcting those problems. Or okay, anybody else?
Making yourself is science.
Science. Okay, anybody else? Balance of energy. Okay. Anybody else? Okay. So we have got different views about Vastu Shastra. Basically, Vastu Shastra, as she said, is popularly known as the science of orienting oneself with the directions. But it is not only that. Well, there is a part of the science which actually deals with that, but it is a much vast science. And you would be surprised that the popular Vastu Shastra which is there today, which tells people to, you know, affix pyramids and, you know, put some idols or some yantras and all, is far more removed from the actual Vastu Shastra which was practiced in our ancient times. So we will have to first look into the basic principles of Vastu Shastra. The lecture will be will progress in the following way. The first I will acquaint you with some basic principles of Vastu Shastra. Then I will go to the allocation of rooms as per the functions. And I will also enlist some of the popular remedies which are there in the our ancient traditional Vastu Shastra. This is a definition of Vastu Shastra from one of the fundamental books on the subject called Manasaram. Vastu is defined as a plot of land used for habitation by mortals and immortals. So Vastu, in fact, is not a building. It is not a house. It is not a certain built-up environment, but it pertains to a plot of land. So this is the basic difference between what is being practiced today and what has been stated in our texts, the original texts. Our philosophy has a tradition of 18 thinkers 18 sages, and most illustrious of them have been Rishi Manasar, who wrote the Manasaram. In the system of this architecture is generally followed in the north side of India, whereas in the south you must have heard of Mayasura. Mayasura was the architect who planned the entire palace of the Pandavas. And Mayasabha was supposed to be very magical. So he is one of the masters of Indian Vastu Shastra. His treatise is called as Mayamatam. It is generally followed in the southern parts of India. And you would be surprised. There are some sites in Mexico which have got temples which are actually like replicas of our temples, which were built thousands of years ago. So many of them now claim that, and you know, there was a civilization called the Mayans. So some people relate Mayasura with the Mayan civilization, and that's why they call now that they say now that Mayasura was a Mexican, in fact. So, and the third illustrious name is that of Maharaja Bhoj of Madhya Pradesh. He ruled Ujjain, and he composed a book called Samarangan Sutradhar. Samarangan Sutradhar is the correlation. It is the thesis written by Maharaja Bhoj, which correlates all the earlier Vastu scientists. That is also a very fundamental book. So whatever is going to be said in this talk will be based upon Mayamatam, Manasaram and Samarangan Sutradhar. So the first is the definition of Vastu. Vastu is defined as a plot of land used for habitation by mortals and immortals. Mortals will, the term mortals refers to human beings as well as animals, domestic animals usually, and immortals refers to celestial beings like gods, goddesses and other entities. First, we will have to see the geographical considerations, which is the most fundamental for any plot of land. India spans from 8 degrees north latitude to 32 degrees north latitude. So if you see Kanyakumari, it is at 8 degrees north latitude from the equator. And say somewhere around Ladakh is around 32 degrees north latitude. So suppose this is the equator, this is 0 degrees, okay? India is somewhere around here, starts from Kanyakumari. It's a trend, Ladakh is somewhere around here, this is around 32 degrees. The sun generally, what do we say? The sun rises in the east. But what the equator actually is on 0 degrees. That is, when the sun is at 0 degrees, that is the proper east. So we shouldn't, for India, when the sun is in northern transition, it travels up to 23.5 degrees, which is somewhere around MP, Madhya Pradesh. So somewhere around Ujjain. So for the rest of the country, The sun is generally towards the south side of the country. It actually is not in the east. It is generally in the southern part of the country. The wind direction is generally from southwest to the northeast. Though in winter, sometimes there are cold winds blowing from the Himalayas to the plains below. Okay. Now we go to the second point. As he said, it is the balancing of energy. So what are these energies? Where do they come from? As the earth revolves around the sun, it follows an elliptical path. There are 27 constellations around that path, which are called nakshatras. That is, they don't change their place. What does not change its place is called nakshatra. What does not change? Naksharati iti nakshatraha. It does not change its place. So there are 27 prominent constellations along that path. And those 27 constellations are divided into 13 and a half constellations, two divisions. This bifurcation has been done by Varaha Mihira, who was a very great astronomer. So the first 13 and a half constellations are called as Devanakshatras, and the next 13 and a half constellations are called as Asura Nakshatras. So the Devanakshatras are influenced the part from north from northwest to southeast, whereas the Asura Nakshatras influence the part from southeast to northwest. Now you can see the cosmic energy which is coming from... Excuse me? Do you have a pointer or something? The cosmic energy which is coming from the north, depicted by these arrows, is called as evolutionary kinetic energy. Whereas the energy which is coming from the south and western parts is called as inertia conducive energy. What do you mean by these terms? Evolution generally means change for the better. So whatever energy coming from, whatever cosmic energy is coming from the north and east is conducive for change for the better. So it is called as evolutionary kinetic energy. Whereas the energy which is coming from the south and west maintains a certain standard of inertia in the house. It is not bad. Generally, in today's Vastu, many people label that houses having entrances at south are not good. But this energy is not bad, but it maintains a sort of inertia. Inertia is termed as, inertia is defined as the tendency of a body to maintain a certain state. If it is stationary, it will remain stationary. If it is already in motion, it will remain in that sort of motion. So this inertia does not, you know, it does not actually bring about any change in the condition of a person, but it maintains that certain state. So you can see in this diagram that the energy coming from the north is obstructed by energy coming from the west. Similarly, energy coming from the east is obstructed by energy coming from the south. The energy coming from the north and east mingle with each other in the northeastern sector. So this northeastern sector is loaded with energy which is useful for bringing about evolution, whereas the southwestern sector is loaded with energy which is conducive to inertia. So this you are. This is a very important and basic fundamental of Vastu. So you have to refer to anything in Vastu has to be referred to this principle. Now we go to the third most important point, the relation of microcosm with the macrocosm. Microcosm generally means this body. And macrocosm is the entire universe. Albert Einstein said that human being is just a part of the whole, which we call as universe, and this part is restricted to